In this video, we're looking at a really interesting problem that I would consider to be on the advanced side, so I'll put an asterisk next to it. So one of the things that makes this a more advanced problem is that we're staying completely general. Everything is given in terms of variable names, and we want to express our final answers in terms of those variable names. And then just the dynamics of the problem could be a little bit difficult to wrap your head around. So what's happening in this problem is I take a disk of mass m, and I spin it really fast with some initial angular velocity of omega naught, and then I drop this thing onto a track, and it begins to slip. So if you drop this disk spinning at a high rate onto the track, it's just going to skid for a while. But as it's skidding, it's accelerating to the right. And so if I look at the contact point here between the disk and the track, I can see that the rotation is pushing to the left on the track, and that means the track is pushing to the right on the disk itself. And I'll call that force little fk, because that's a force exerted parallel to a surface caused by the slipping between the two surfaces. In other words, it's a kinetic friction force. The other forces acting on this disk are gravity acting downward on the center of mass, that's little mg, and then the normal force exerted at the contact point by that track, and that's pointing up. And because there is no acceleration happening perpendicular to the track, that normal force must be equal to mg. One more thing I'll pop into the diagram before we get started is that the kinetic friction force is given by mu k, the coefficient of kinetic friction, multiplied by the normal force, which I just figured out from a quick calculation was mg. So now we're going to get into all the parts of the problem. And what you see in this picture, A and B, that's only part of it. There's also parts C through D, and we'll get into those on the next slide. So first, getting the acceleration of the disk is not that bad. I just apply Newton's second law in the x direction. So F net equals mass times the acceleration of the center of mass. Well, there's only one force acting in the x direction, and it's that kinetic friction force. And I'll go ahead and plug that in since we already wrote it as mu kmg. We have mu kmg is equal to m, a center of mass. And so it turns out the acceleration of the center of mass of this disk during this slipping phase is equal to mu k times g. In part B, we want to get the angular acceleration during the slipping phase. So now I have to think about what torque is being experienced by this disk with respect to the center of mass. So this disk is rotating clockwise, but if I look at the force exerted by the kinetic friction, that's causing a counterclockwise torque, and that's why this thing is slowing down. The force of gravity and the normal force, those aren't exerting any torques at all because they point straight down the lever arm. So what we're applying here is the rotational equivalent of Newton's second law. That's the sum of all the torques is equal to I times alpha, where I is the moment of inertia, alpha is the angular acceleration. And I'm just going to work in magnitudes for the moment. We will have to make a minus sign adjustment later on. So the torque exerted by that friction force is just given by the size of that force times the lever arm, but the lever arm is just the radius of the disk. I also know the moment of inertia of a disk is 1/2 mr². And then my only unknown here is the angular acceleration. So we plug in the magnitude of the friction force, that's mu kmg, and I'll go ahead and cancel an r out of the previous step. And so this is equal to 1/2 m times r times alpha. Now the mass of the disk cancels out, and I get that the magnitude of the angular acceleration is 2 mu kg divided by r. So we know how fast the disk is speeding up as it goes faster and faster down the track. And we know how fast it's slowing down in its rotation. Now we get to the really interesting part of the problem. Eventually the disk will transition to rolling without slipping, and after that roll with a constant velocity to a good approximation. So how do we figure out how far does it go and how long does it take before it starts rolling without slipping? Well, that's what the rest of the problem is about. So I grabbed our answers to part A and B and put them in the upper right-hand corner for reference. And in part C, we're asked to compute the time for which the disk slips before it begins rolling without slipping. And so the key physical point here is that the disk initially starts with a velocity of 0. The moment it lands on that track, it's just skidding and it's not moving translationally yet. It gradually speeds up to the right, and when it hits this special moment where its translational speed is equal to r times its rotational speed, that's the moment you're rolling without slipping. In other words, it's going fast enough now where the contact point with the track is momentarily stationary at every moment in time. So what we want to do is look at the speed as a function of time and the rotation rate as a function of time. And then we'll figure out what time it is when the speed and the rotation rate match this special condition to cause rolling without slipping. In my speed as a function of time, I just use my acceleration of the center of mass. in the classic kinematics formula, V equals V naught plus AT, and V naught is zero. And I find that the speed as a function of time is simply mu kg times t. And then I look at the spin rate as a function of time, and this is just omega naught plus alpha t. Now I know that the spin rate is slowing down. And in part B, I wrote down a magnitude of the angular acceleration. Here's where I need to put in a minus sign. If I'm going to count the initial spin rate as positive, I have to count the angular acceleration as negative. And now I'm going to enforce the rolling without slipping condition. I want V to be equal to R omega. At that point, we transition to rolling without slipping because that guarantees that the contact point with the track is stationary. So I take my expression for V as a function of time, mu k gt, and when that's equal to R times omega, and we plug in omega as a function of time, that's the moment we transition to rolling without slipping. I'll go ahead and distribute that little R, and I get a R omega naught minus 2 mu k gt. And then notice that I have a minus 2 mu k gt on the right-hand side and 1 mu k gt on the left-hand side. So I can just combine those like terms on the left, and I have three of them. I get 3 mu k gt is equal to R omega naught. Finally, I can solve for the time, and I get R omega naught over 3 mu k g. Next, I want to get the distance through which the disk is slipping before it begins rolling without slipping. So now I know the time it does this, and I know the acceleration during that time. That's the A center of mass I computed originally. So I just use a kinematics equation for this. It's just x equals x naught plus v naught t plus 1/2 at squared. And the initial position I'm calling zero. The final position in the diagram was actually called little d, so I'm going to replace it with that. And then my initial translational velocity was zero. And so I get little d is equal to 1/2 times the acceleration, which is mu kg, multiplied by the time for the acceleration squared. So that's r omega naught over 3 mu kg, all squared. So if I handle the constants first after squaring this second piece, that's going to give me a 9 in the denominator. I can collect that with the 1/2 out in front and get an 18 in the denominator. And when I square the mu kg in this second piece, one of those is going to cancel with the one that's out in front, but it leaves me with a mu kg in the denominator. And then in my numerator, I have r squared omega naught squared. And that's a fine way to leave the answer. Finally, in part E, we want the speed of the disk at the moment it begins rolling without slipping. And again, this is just basic kinematics applied to the acceleration that we already calculated and the amount of time it was accelerating. So I write down V equals V naught plus AT. The initial translational speed of the disk was zero. The acceleration of the disk was mu kg. The time it accelerated for is r omega naught over 3 mu kg. And we get a really elegant answer out of this. So a mu kg is going to cancel. And it turns out the speed that it's moving after all this slipping is done is just 1/3 r omega naught. And we're done.
If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.